The Lord right now has got me dealing with the marriage. So, and not so much a marriage as far as, you know, teaching on the marriage, how our relationship as husband and wife, is the same, you know, here. We have a head, which is, you know, Jesus Christ. And he is our head, and he is the head of the church. And we're the bride, and he's the bridegroom. So the marriage that we experience here, I'm going to read something about, we learn from this marriage, and we can have a, he gives us the natural things so that we can understand the things of the Spirit. And one thing I taught when I taught a marriage life group one time is about how, you know, a husband and a wife, you know, a husband is not to lord over her wife, over his wife, but to lay down his life for her. Just like Christ has laid down his life for the church. Now what that means is that, you know, we're all brides. And, you know, just as a husband has a bride, so, you know, we're the bride of Christ, and this is his house, not this building. But we as brides ought to work in the house of Yeshua, in the house of Jesus. So until our head comes, that's what we're doing. We're busy. We take care of his house. We feed the sick. I mean, we pray for the sick. We feed the hungry. We help one another. And we're supposed to all be good brides. And the importance about that is that you have to have communication with the head in order for you and I to be productive. If you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, well, then your productivity is going to be null. It's going to be very little. The more you come into intimacy with Jesus Christ, the more seed is deposited into you, the more you have to give, the more offspring you're going to have, because you have more of him in you. And what people are looking to see is not you, but Jesus in you, right? So if someone, you know, now not saying we don't show ourselves, because ourselves is nasty, but when people see us, I mean, who do they see? They're supposed to see Jesus. Now, yeah, they're going to see other things, but, you know, because we're still in the flesh. But for the most part, you know, they need to see Jesus. Who is the one that you're in love with? You ever get someone who, you know, has a new girlfriend, a boyfriend, and the only one they talk about, only person they talk about is that new girlfriend or that new boyfriend? Because they everything. You know, that's what it's really about. If you don't have that love for Jesus Christ, something is wrong. Something is wrong. I mean, he is everything.
Amen.
And your focus needs to be him. You know, if you don't have that, ask him for it.
Amen.
I mean, I'm continually, you know, Lord, you know, I want more. Fill me with more. You know, I want more of you. Because you're going to find out that nothing here satisfies.
Amen.
And once you've been fed a little, you want more. You know, you want more of him.
Amen.
And that's, you know, this marriage is something for you and I to look forward to. I mean, if you're not excited about that, if you're not looking for that,
amen.
Well then, you know, you need to examine yourself. The Bible says to even see whether you're in the faith or not. Don't get distracted with the things that are around you, which are temporary. They are temporary. The main focus in life, and I'm not talking about we have to pay bills and do certain things, but the main focus in life, man, is for you and me to be passionately and intimately in love with Jesus Christ. If you haven't experienced that beyond anything, if you've been saved already, you need to ask for that. You need to continually ask for that and keep on asking for that until you get it. And bother him until you get it.
Amen.
Don't ask just one time. I mean, I was yesterday. There's dry times that you go through and all of this stuff. And yesterday I told the Lord, man, Lord, I need help, man. I need help. I don't love you any less, but I do want more of you. And I'm longing to see him. Because he's what's important. He is everything. The word the Lord had put on me, you know, for this Passover was the word invitation. And he told me, you know, that it's all about his coming.
Amen.
It's all about looking for the blessed hope. It's all about looking for his return. And but we don't want to just be looking for his return when the only thing that you and I can give back to Jesus Christ is others. That's the only jewel that you can give back to him. That's why there's, you know, a crown of salvation. You know, the crowns that we throw at his feet represent things. There's like five different crowns in the Bible. But the only thing that we can offer back up to Jesus, once you're saved, if you bury what you got and he comes, and here I am, Lord, well, you're gone. You understand that? Your history. If you bury your talent, you're gone. It was given to you so that it will multiply.
Amen.
So whatever it is that you've given, you have to sow it. Whether it's, you know, food or money or you yourself or whatever. You have to sow back into others. So the invitation that the Lord had sent, you know, it started in Matthew 28:19, where he said, "Go ye therefore into all the world and preach the gospel." Remember that? Baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And that has never been rescinded or recalled back to you and me. Meaning the mission for you and me still today is to win souls. Because that is the only thing that we can offer back unto Jesus.
Amen.
And we'll find out in the Brit Hadashah, the New Testament or the New Covenant, that's all Paul was you know, worried about, was bringing others. He wasn't worried about building on somebody else's faith or foundation, or building on a foundation, should I say. He wanted to lay a foundation. That means he wanted to win souls over for him, for Jesus Christ, right? So let's kind of get into this. It's pretty good. It's where the Lord took me. The Lord told me that this year is the year of invitation. That's what he said this year is, the year of invitation. I don't think it's by any coincidence that you know, Passover time is a time to where he called, it was a Passover or a feast, the spring feast, where they had to come to Jerusalem, so the call was to come, right? So this is a call right now that's going out to come unto Jesus, right? This goes back, when I started this study, I had some notes I had taken in my Bible, and it was from 2009, and it was Brother Richard Hanahosi had preached this message, part of this message in what I'm going to give you. And this was in mid-January of 2009, so this was exactly 7 years ago, a complete cycle. And exactly where I started reading is I had some notes, and this is what Brother Richard had said. And this was his going away sermon. Now, what's crazy about that? In 2009, Brother Richard, or Pastor Richard Hanahosi, was actually asked to shepherd another church in 2009. And this was his last message he gave at Resurrection Life before he had left to go, where he was, you know, going to become this new shepherd. And where I thought that I was going to be raised up to take his position. But God had other plans. So this is exactly 7 years ago. This is a complete cycle. And this is what he had wrote. I took some notes. And I believe it's been exactly 7 years, right? We in April now. This was in January 11th of 09. So it's been 7 years and a couple of months. And the call was, he said in 2009, this is the year of invitation. This was his going away sermon. He was going somewhere. He was invited, right, to go to be a pastor of another church. So this is a time of invitation. And that's what he wrote right here. First time I'm seeing it was yesterday, the year of invitation. And he wrote on it, this is what the Lord had spoke to him. To come to the water, that was number one. God's call is to come to the water, come to the light, come closer to me, and come up higher. So the call for you and me today is to come. But not only for us, the bid is to go out and call them
Amen.
To come. to the invitation. Because that's what it's about. That's the only thing that's going to, you know, that we're going to have to offer back up to him. This is what I wrote. It's the year of invitation. Number one, it says, is to come up, come to the water, which is the word. Come to the light, which is Jesus Christ. The Bible says, come closer to me, right? And also, he said, come up higher. I want to start reading with you guys in Luke chapter 14, verse 15 through 24. And before I start that, I want to read this to you as a marriage goes. As human life finds its highest fulfillment in the love of men, listen to this. As human life finds its highest fulfillment in the love of men and women, so our spiritual life finds its highest fulfillment in the love of God for his people and Christ for the church. If you're looking for something in someone else to, you know, it's not going to fulfill you.
Come on.
If you're looking for me to, you know, to continually give you an experience with God, I'm going to fail you. You have to, as an individual, like this morning, my goats, you know, gave birth. I was right there assisting my goats in birth. Well, I watched that little one. I watched that little one get strength in its legs, stand up, and the first thing it went to the milk. It went looking for the teat. I mean, if you don't feed, well then you're gonna be miserable. You're gonna feel miserable. Then if you're not feeding, well then other things is gonna take the place in your life, you know, whether it's jobs or money or boats or sewing or farming or whatever it is, everything else is gonna take priority, and you're gonna find out that those things will get you in trouble.
Yeah.
Amen.
Because when they were bidded to come to the marriage, when they were bidded, they were all bidded to come to the marriage. And when the marriage feast had been set and prepared, then the father said, now go and tell them to come. Right?
Amen.
So they go out there and said, hey, the father has set the table. The food is all out on the table. It's ready to come. Well, the first one says, well, look, you know, go tell the father he needs to excuse me because I just bought some property I got to go look at. Right? And then he went to the next one to bid him to come. And he said, hey, you know, he went to the next person. He said, the father said the marriage table set and ready. Come and eat. And then this one says, go tell the father that I just bought some land and I need to go look at it. And I bought some oxen and I got to go look at them. And he went to another one and he said, hey, the marriage feast is set. You see, the invitation already went out and the invitation was accepted to come to the marriage. These invitations went out. And then he goes to him, okay, you got your invitation and you accepted, it's ready. And then that person says, hey, go tell the father that, you know, I just got married and I can't come. The Bible says that the father was angry.
That's right.
He was angry. And then he said, he was angry with them. And he said, you tell them that they're not going to feast from my table after being bidden. That means everybody in here has been bidden to come to the Lord. Every one of you. You've received a call to come to the master's table, the messianic table. That's what it is. And he said, you tell them. They were bidden and they said they was going to come, but they didn't. So they're not going to eat from the Messiah's table. But now you go into the highways and the byways and you bid them come. And you tell the lame, the maimed, and the orphan, you tell them to come. Because my house has to be full.
Amen.
It has to be full. We'll take that upon ourselves. You've been bidden to come, but then we let other things get in our way. The table is always open for you and me to come to Jesus to feed, whether it's milk or meat. And if you are not feeding, you're going to get caught up in other things. Well, I can't make it today. I can't come to church. I got to go here or I got to go there. You think it's a light thing, but you'll fall into something that's very easy that you can get used to doing. Then the next thing you know, you're not coming. So therefore, you're missing the meat or the milk of the word. Every time you miss, you get malnutritioned.
Amen.
Right. Why? Because most are not feeding themselves.
Right.
Think about it. So as human life finds its highest fulfillment in the love of men and women, like I said, you're not feeding from the master's table, you're going to pour yourself into something else. And guess what? Something always will be, excuse me. Oh, can you tell the pastor that I won't be there this week because I had to do this or do that? Something else will always take priority to the word. You fall in that rut, the next thing you know, you'll miss his coming.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, that's kind of like the 10 virgins running out of oil. Wow.
Amen.
The only way you can get the oil is from the house, right? So our spiritual life finds its highest fulfillment in the love of God for his people and Christ for his church. In the New Testament, the church is seen as the bride of Christ. In 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 2, in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 23 through 25, and Revelation chapter 19, 7 through 9, and chapter 21, verse 9. The church is the bride. We are the bride of Jesus Christ. And a bride, more than ever in Israel, the only thing they ever wanted to do, what was the worst thing that could happen to a woman in Israel is that they were barren.
Right.
Let me die if the fruit of my womb don't come forth.
Amen.
That is how we are supposed to be. You're not to be barren in your life. And the only way you won't be barren in your life is to have a personal relationship, intimacy with Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Right? In the New Testament, the church is seen as the bride of Christ. Let's go to Luke chapter 14, and I'm going to start reading to you there. Luke chapter 14, and I'm going to start in verse 1. And it came to pass as he went into the house of one of the chief Pharisees to eat bread on the Sabbath day, that they watched him. And behold, there was a certain man before him who had the dropsy. And Jesus answered, spake unto the lawyers and the Pharisees, saying, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath? And they held their peace. And he took him and healed him and let him go. And he answered them, saying, which of you shall have an ass or an ox fallen into a pit, and will not straightway pull him out on the Sabbath day? And they could not answer him again. And he put forth a parable to those which were bidden. See, the Pharisees and Sadducees were bidded to come.
Yeah.
So watch. Now he's going to talk to him. He says, verse 7, and he put forth a parable to those which were bidden, when he marked how they chose out the chiefest rooms, saying unto them, when thou art bidden of any man to a wedding, sit not down in the highest room, lest one more honorable man come in, than thou be bidden of him will come in. And he that bade thee, and him come and say to thee, give this man place, and thou begin with shame to take the lowest room. So this is about a marriage, right? Being bidden. They come to a marriage. The Pharisees and Sadducees walk in there. They want to take the highest spots, getting closest, to whoever's hosting the wedding. They want to take the chiefest positions. But when thou art bidden, go and sit down in the lowest room. And when he that bade thee cometh, he may say unto thee, friend, go up higher. Then thou shalt have worship in the presence of them that sit at meat with thee. For whosoever exalteth himself shall be abased, and he that humbleth himself shall be exalted. Then said he also him that bade him. Then said he also to him that called him, when thou makest a dinner or a supper, call not thy friends. Now this is, I'm going into, when we get down to verse 15, this is the parable of the great supper where I wanted to take you guys, but I got to read the context before so you know what's going on. So the context before was about a marriage, right? See how he's talking about a marriage, and then he's going to move into the next thing. He says, then said he also to him that bade him, when thou makest a dinner or a supper, call not thy friends, nor thy brethren, neither thy kinsmen, nor thy rich neighbors, lest they also bid thee again, and recompense thee that has made thee. So you throw a big party, yeah, you call all your big friends over there, well, they got money too. Next week they call you over. This is not what the bid is about. He says, but when thou makest a feast, call the poor, the maimed, the lame, and the blind. Well, the poor have no money. The maimed, you know, they are crippled. You know, they have, so, you know, they don't have any money either. Most of them were beggars, right? No, don't worry about the kids. They're okay, Holly. They're all good. The lame and the blind. These are all of these people here are all, they're all people that can't support themselves because they're either lame or blind or maimed. So they can't support themselves. So these people can't pay you back.
Right?
He says, and when you invite them, and thou shalt be blessed, for they cannot recompense thee, for thou shalt be recompensed at the resurrection of the just. So there is a resurrection, right? We're going to be taken away. So what? He threw this in here. Thou will be recompensed at the resurrection. So at his coming, when he calls us. So we're all servants in the house of God to serve those who are less fortunate. So that's why this marriage thing that's coming on Passover, you know, I didn't want you to go invite other, you know, not that other churches are not welcome, other parts of the body, but it's more about those that can't repay us. You know what I mean? It's not a call, look, we just want to bless. And when we want to bless, we want to pour it out on them. And this whole feast is all about an invitation so that they too can meet Jesus.
Yeah.
Right? That's why I said last Wednesday, I'm not worried about you guys. It ain't about you. And it's not about me. It's about them that are lost. Now, verse 15, the parable of the great supper. He says, and when one of them that sat at meat with him had heard these things, he said unto him, blessed is he that shall eat bread in the kingdom of God. That's one of the Pharisees that's sitting down with him. He says, blessed is he. And one of them that sat at meat with him heard these things, and he said unto him, blessed is he that shall eat bread in the kingdom of God. Listen to how he takes it now, the Lord. He says, then said he unto him, a certain man made a great supper and bade many, called many. And he sent his servant at supper time to say to them that were bidden. To say to them that were bidden. Remember I was telling you guys before? They've been called. They've already received an invitation. Come, for all the things are ready now. And they, with one consent, began to make an excuse. I mean, don't make an excuse not to be here in church. Because when you're not here, you're missed. I'm telling you. You know, it's... You don't realize how important it is that you're here feeding. You have to. He said, and they all with one consent began to make an excuse. The first said unto him, I have bought a piece of ground, and I must needs to go see it. Well, that's a lie. How's that a lie? Has anybody in here ever bought a piece of ground without looking at it?
No.
Have you ever purchased anything without looking at it? Huh? That's an excuse.
Amen.
Oh, I bought a piece of ground and I need to go look at it. Oh, you didn't look at it? You didn't go look at it? Oh yeah, I looked at it, but I need to go look at it again. That's an excuse, right?
Amen.
Watch number two. Next one. He says, the first said unto him, I bought a piece of ground and I must needs go see it. I pray thee, have me excused. You're not excused. He's not excused. In fact, he missed the wedding because he was more concerned about earthly things rather than heavenly things. Look at the next one. Another said, I have bought 5 yoke of oxen and I go to prove them. I pray thee, let me be excused. Wait, you've bought oxen that you're going to plow your field with and you never seen them plow before? Cherie, you buy a horse without trying him? He's lying too. His heart's not there. The Bible says excuses are lies. That's what that is right there. But they were bidden. They were part. Another said, I have bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I need to go prove them. I pray that you excuse me. Another said, I have married a wife, and therefore I cannot come. Why did he say that? Well, because in the Torah, in Leviticus, it says when a man marries a woman, he's to do nothing for 1 year. That's right. Did you know that? He can't go to war for 1 year. He needs to stay with his wife for 1 year.
Oh,
yeah. To do nothing. That's his court. That's his marriage time with his wife for 1 year. But there's a problem here. The Bible says that he could stay home 1 year. Let's keep reading. You're going to find out why. Watch this. And another said, I've married a wife, and therefore I cannot come. Deuteronomy 24:5. That's what you can read it right there in Deuteronomy 24:5. Watch this. So that the servant came and showed his lord these things. Then the master of the house, being angry, said to his servant, go out quickly into the streets and the lanes of the city, and bring in hither the poor, the maimed, the halt, and the blind. That's why Jesus didn't come to the Pharisees and Sadducees and pick them out 12 disciples.
That's right.
He went down to the Sea of Galilee and got some uneducated fishermen.
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
And the servant said, Lord, it is done, and thou hast that thou hast commanded, and yet there is room. And the Lord said unto the servant, go out into the highways and the hedges, and compel them. Compel them. That's what this invitation is about. Don't take no for an answer, especially if you want to see some of your loved ones saved. Compel them. Man, the food is going to be amazing. They're going to have everything. You got to come check this out. They got something that's going on over there that's going to blow you away.
Amen.
You're not lying. It is.
Amen.
It's going to blow that doors off. If you really want to see him saved, and hey, that's all you can do is compel them, invite them to come. And they might say, yeah, I'm coming, and not show up.
That's right.
Don't be like them. Remember that last servant I told you about, number 20? And another said, I have married a wife, and therefore I cannot come. Jesus is going to deal with him too. But it's a few verses ahead. Watch how he deals with that remark. And the Lord said unto his servant, go out into the highways and the hedges, and compel them to come in, that my house may be filled. That's what I want. I want a filled house. Overflowing, right? A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, runneth over, shall men give unto your bosom. Right? That's what God wants.
Amen.
God wants a good measure.
Yes.
Verse 24. For I say unto you, that none of those men, none of the ones that were I mentioned to you, which were bidden, shall taste of the supper. That supper is the messianic supper.
Yes.
That's the Messiah's table. Yes. That's when the Lord returns. That's what that word means right there. This is Jesus talking about his kingdom, his wedding, his bidding them to come. What table you think he's talking about right there? I bid them to come, and because they made an excuse, they're not going to eat from the king's table, my table.
Amen.
Having your feet under, you know, having Mephibosheth's feet under the king's table. Man. That was the maimed and the lame Mephibosheth.
Yeah.
Jonathan's son, who can I bless in the house of Saul? Mephibosheth, lame from the nurse, carried him out when they come to king, kill all the king's line.
Exactly.
Running out, the nurse dropped him. He was lamed in his legs. Who was David inviting to the table? Was it the big money men? Hey, how about we move the church to Covington and get all the rich people and we can grow this thing? No, how about we go in the ghetto? How about we start one in Derby? How about we start one right here in Mississippi where there is no money?
Amen.
That's right. Go ahead.
Amen.
That's where Jesus would be.
Amen.
Let's scope out the areas where we could put a church. Mandeville. Whoo, the doctors are there. Well, I ain't Church of the King, and I ain't talking about a church, because Church of the King would be in a ghetto. It'd kind of be like, it wasn't in Jerusalem, it was in Galilee. That's where he began his ministry. Let me go up there to Jerusalem by the Pharisees and Sadducees. Oh, maybe we'll move the church over there by the Greeks. Ooh, the Greeks had the money, son.
Go ahead.
Jesus, the Greeks are out there, they want to see you. They got big money. Unless a grain of wheat falls to the ground, Peter, it'll abide by itself. But if it dies, it'll bring forth much fruit.
Amen. Amen.
What did you say? He's tripping on that one. He's talking about his death, burial, and resurrection. And Peter, you ain't going to get nothing unless you die too and stop worrying about the money. In fact, go catch a fish. That's how we'll pay the taxes. The money's in its mouth.
That's right.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. It ain't about fancy buildings or fancy speeches or how elegant you are that you speak and talk. Let's go back, because those guys are going to miss the feast. For I say unto you, verse 24, none of those men which were bidden shall taste of my supper. Man. Wow. So now, remember verse 20? Hey, I'm married. I got to be with my wife. I can't come to church. I got to stay home with my wife. I can't come, but you got some other things to do. Let's see how Jesus handles that. Because you see, verse 20 is now, he's going to apply, he's going to talk about verse 20 and verse 25 and on. Listen what he says. And there were great multitudes with him, and he turned and said to them, if any man come to me and hates not his father and his mother, in wife, in children, in brethren, in sisters, yea, in his own life also, cannot be my disciple. Son. Now, he said wife. He said wife.
Why did he say hate?
Huh?
Why did he say hate?
That word hate means... that word hate right there doesn't mean to hate him. It means if you don't love him more than them.
Amen.
He said, let me tell you what he's saying. So you who has a wife that I bade to come and follow me, and you said, you know, hey, I just got married. If you love her more than you love me, you're not worthy to sit down at my table. That's why Jesus is everything.
Amen.
You don't let family keep you out. Because your family is going to be the one that turns on you in the end. The Bible says.
Amen.
Mother will betray, you know, daughter and daughter, mother and brother, sister, sister, brother, father, son, son, brother. Listen to what he says. He's addressing it now to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. Here, you can just test yourself right now to see whether you're in the faith or not. Let's see. Verse 27 is up there. 28. For which of you intending to build is 27. Did I read 27?
You read 27.
For which of you intending to build a tower?
Read 27.
That's right.
You already read 27.
No, I never. He says, if any man come to me and loves his father and mother and wife and children and brethren and sisters more than me, he cannot be my disciple. That's why the disciples said, we've left everything for you. We've left, you know, in one of the writings, it said one of the hardest things for Peter to do was sell his boat.
Sounds familiar.
Said it was all of us.
Can you imagine? Peter, you know, Jesus died and rose again. When Jesus died, Peter said, I'm going fishing. He went back to the boat.
Yeah.
That's why Jesus met him out there by the boat. Hey, Peter, you going to follow me? Stop fishing for fish. You have to now fish for men. What does that mean? Sell a boat? You love me more, Peter?
You don't have to sell the boat.
Peter. Do you love your boat more than me? If you do, you're not worthy of me. Do you want me to get rid of my boat? What about my wife? What about my family? Peter, if they won't follow you, follow me. And you know, I remember in my mom's life,
yeah.
I remember my daddy told my mama,
yeah.
Patsy, it's either Jesus Christ or me. Make your choice.
Ooh. Ooh. Wait, he said it's either the church or me, because he wouldn't say it's either Jesus or me. God gave me that exact scripture that liked to kill me. But he gave it to me for a reason. God is so good. When he gave me that scripture, I broke so bad. And I got indignant with God. And I said, what do you mean, God, I'm not worthy of you? I do love my husband. I mean, I can touch him, God. I wash his clothes. I mean, we sleep together. I cook his meals. God, what do you mean I'm not worthy of you? And I cried so bad, because I felt like he was saying, Pat, you're not worthy of me. And I just went from the bed down on my knees, because that's where I was reading, and crying. And when I couldn't cry no more, I said, God, I know you're supposed to be first, and I can't do it, so you have to do it. I know you're supposed to be first. So I was acknowledging Bobby was first, and I really didn't know it, but I saw it then, because the Holy Spirit dealt with me. And I said, but I can't do it. You've got to do it, God. You've got to do it. So God did it. And let me tell you why God did it. The only one who could have taken me away from him would have been Bobby, my husband. Because my love for my husband was very, very great. But let me tell you something else, how much he loves me. He loved me. My husband was out that night in a bar when I was reading my Bible in bed that night. And when my husband came home, he looked at me and he said, Pat, it's either that church or it's me. And I'm going to tell you something right now. If God hadn't did what he did in me that night, I was so dependent that I had served my husband. But God did such a work in me. I looked at him and I said, Bob, go do what you gotta do. I said, but I've got to stay with God. He broke, he fell on his knees, and he grabbed my leg, and he said, never stop praying for me. So that scripture is a powerful scripture. But I want to let you know, God does things for a reason. Because your wife, your husband, is very, very close to you. And you have to love God more. Because if that wife or that husband stands up to you and says, look, I had enough of this, and I'm not going to serve God anymore, who are you going to serve? Are you going to still stay with God, or are you going to go with your man?
And now for closing that.
In verse 28, you know, it's hard, but you know, you will feel like that when you meet him personally. When you truly meet Jesus Christ personally, man, he is like, I can't even begin to tell you. I mean, you in love with him, and anyway, he says, and I guess the reason I'm telling you guys this is because what's more important for you and I right now is to lead people to Jesus. That's the most important thing. That's what this message is about. It's about the invitation. It's about you keeping Jesus Christ first in your life, being committed to him more than being committed to any other thing in your life. Amen. That is the most important thing in your life, because if you're not, you'll stand a chance on missing it. The world will sweep you away so fast. He says in verse 28, for which of you intending to build a tower? Yeah, yes.
Hold on, you keep skipping 27.
Oh, 27.
Oh, you keep messing me up.
Brother Tony, 27.
Hold on.
And you know, 27 is the number of rest, too. It's where we find our rest. You know, he says, and whosoever doth not bear his cross, that means die to self, and come after me, cannot be my disciple.
Yes.
And you know what, Tony?
Amen. He's like, you read it.
And that's where we're going to end.
You can't skip it. That one way to skip it.
If you cannot, it's about, you know, who can't bear his cross and die to self. You know, it's the only way. When Jesus Christ is everything to you, well then, he's what you want to talk about. It's easy to get caught up in the rat race that's out there. You know, because you constantly have to make money to pay bills. You constantly have to do this or do that. And what happens is you lose focus of what's the most important thing in life.
Amen.
The most important thing in life is your personal relationship with Jesus Christ and you inviting others to him. Like that man said when John and I went on that little job check, went to check out on a job. Man, do you tell anybody about Jesus today? I mean, this man, and then next thing you know, he's, you know, you can't keep him quiet, you know? And then he brought us in the office and sat us down. We had to listen to it for half an hour. We were sitting an hour there. John, after it was over, was like, what are we going to do now? You know, it's amazing. But hey, stay focused. You know, if you haven't really, truly met Jesus Christ, you know, in a deep personal way, and I'm talking deep, man. I'm talking about where he's the one that you yearn for. Yeah. Well, then there's something that you haven't received yet. And you need that. You need it. Because that is what will change your life. You know, like I said before, you know, well, I know Jesus. Well, does Jesus know you? And when Jesus knows you, well, then, you know, your life is different. So we're inviting people to a marriage. It's going to be absolutely amazing. However you can help, we're going to need support in a big way.